So we're back to chapter 11. So again, this kind of the Hall of Fame of Faith, sometimes it's referred to as I mentioned in the prayer in chapter 12, he'll make reference to a great cloud of witnesses, and these are the individuals that are mentioned here. In chapter 11, Paul is, again, our writer has concluded chapter 10, as you recall, saying that, quoting Habakkuk, saying that the just will live by faith. And then in verse 1, he doesn't really give us a definition of faith, but tells us what faith does, where it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And then he takes us on this journey through these different individuals, and we've already covered the ones prior to the flood, and now we're looking at who we refer to as the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and also Joseph. Again, in verse 2, at the beginning of that chapter, he says, for by it the elders obtained a good testimony. Those are the individuals we're looking at, and certainly we're looking at their good testimonies. And one of the things that we'll see, and is certainly more helpful had you been with us for a study in Genesis, is that there was a lot of things that could have highlighted about these individuals that were not a good testimony. But what's highlighted, are you kind of hoping for that, that your testimony will reel when it's shown in heaven one day? It kind of highlights the good stuff and not the bad stuff. But that's what we're getting here in the life of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. Well, let's look at first, as we, again, last time we were already introduced to Abraham and their miracle son, Isaac. Now we have what we're calling the proving or the testing of Abraham's faith. That's in verse 17 and 19, again, in Hebrews 11. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. And he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Again, the word begotten, that's not, it only means unique. Abraham has other sons, of course. Verse 18, of whom it was said, and Isaac your seed shall be called, concluding that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, for which he also received him in a figurative way. So, a couple of things about this scene that is covered in Genesis 22 and in all of these characters and stories and narratives that are mentioned. Of course, we'll jump back and look at those things, those stories in context as we get to them. But first note that the response of Abraham was immediate. When God tested him, it says he offered. And so the idea, it was immediate. In Genesis 22:3, it says, early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey. In other words, there was no thinking it over. There was no procrastination. And one of the things that we're going to see, especially in Abraham in Isaac as well, and Jacob, is that they obeyed God in faith despite their personal feelings. And obviously, he loved Isaac, and so this request, this command by God, had to be overwhelming. It's interesting because Moses doesn't write about it in that sense. He tells us nothing of the feelings of Abraham at all. Of course, the writer there in Genesis. Either way, Abraham put his feelings, personal feelings, aside in order to obey. And that's one of the important things that we want to learn or see in this, is that sometimes, in order to obey the Lord, to walk in faith, it means we take our personal feelings and we put them aside in order to obey the Lord. Warren Wordsby says, our faith is not really tested until God asks us to bear what seems unbearable, to do what seems unreasonable, and to expect what seems impossible. Whether it's Joseph in prison, Moses and Israel at the edge of the Red Sea, David hiding in a cave, Jesus at Calvary, the lesson is the same. They put personal feelings aside and acted in faith to the known will of God. Now, Abraham had certainly learned a lot of lessons in his faith journey. Remember, God calls him to leave Ur, the Chaldeans, leave his family and so forth, go to the land, I'll show you. Well, he takes some of his family with him and he moves upriver. not great, but at least he got off the dime and went somewhere. But it's a while before his father Terah dies, and he finally journeys on to where the Lord is leading him. He's got other issues, though. When there's a famine in the land, he goes to Egypt. He lies about Sarah, his wife. All these things. There's a lot of times. I actually had a running scoreboard for Abraham when we did the study, how many times he failed the test of faith. But it is incredible by the time we get to chapter 22, and he is able to do what he does here and respond and obey immediately. Genesis 22, it says, concluding God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from which he also received him in a figurative sense. Offering Isaac as a sacrifice is just not bogged down too much. It's in a perfect tense. It's like a completed act. There was no hesitation. He was ready. In a sense, he did do it. Now, Isaac's life, as you know the story, was never taken. But as far as Abraham's part, he did everything that God asked him to do. Secondly, Abraham's reasoning was a key component of his faith. That's in verse 19. And that's with the word where it starts concluding. The NIV uses the word reasoning that God was able to raise him up even from the dead. God had told Abraham that he would have children as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand of the sea. And God believed, Abraham believed him, Genesis 15, 6, and it was accredited to him as righteousness. God had said through Isaac a great covenant would come and blessings would come through his life. And Abraham believed God that he would have this promised child, even though his body was as good as dead. He's 100 and his wife is Sarah is 90. Abraham knew that Isaac could come through a miraculous prophetic word. So he reasons and concludes through all of this that God has made these promises, and basically, God's on the hook for this. I mean, whatever he's got to do, the Lord tells him to do, even if he has to plunge a knife into his son and take his life, God is going to raise him up from the dead. Keep in mind that Isaac is probably in his early 20s at this point. He's no little boy, so he's he's going along with the whole deal as well. And that'll be an interesting story to be told someday in heaven as well. But again, God would keep his word. Genesis 22:5, Abraham says, "Stay here with the donkey," he told his servants, "while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham is going to do what God is asking him to do, but he has no doubt that Isaac has to be coming back with him because he is the promised child. Again, in verse 3, I'm sure Abraham understood this that we mentioned a few weeks ago. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. When God created the universe as we know it, he made something out of nothing. And we can also conclude, and we also can reason, when it seems like all circumstances are against us, we still can trust the Lord. That's the whole point of it. And some of you certainly, like myself, bear witness to that more than others, the idea of making something out of nothing. And we thank the Lord for it. So Abraham reasons that God created the universe and everything in it. Abraham reasons and concludes that he brought forth a son at the age of 100. He reasons and concludes that he's promised a covenant oath with him by which he must keep his word. Isaac has to have descendants. Therefore, it would be reasonable to believe that even if he took the life of his son, God would raise him back from the dead. And because of his obedience, in a figurative sense, the writer says, that's exactly what happened. But I think to really appreciate this, you have to kind of go through and read all the fumblings and everything of Abraham. I think that's the wonderful thing here is that we see that in the life of Abraham, like our lives, we're not always so great. We're not always so trusting the Lord, but we learn how trustworthy He is. And if we keep getting up and walking with Him, our faith grows. And of course, even as we sing that song that this morning, give us grace, you know, that we might trust you more. And certainly we're praying for that, but our experiences with the Lord, like Abraham, certainly will bring that about as well. And our faith will be tested. Again, another Warren Wordsby line, faith that is not tested is faith that is not trusted, and the Lord will test our faith. But God allows that so that we might grow in our faith and trust in Him. Secondly, then, we get to Isaac. Isaac died in faith, we're saying, believing the promises of the future. Verse 20, by faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau, his two sons, concerning things to come. And his whole life, he gets one line. But here's the story. Again, like Abraham, Isaac has his... He has his real ups and downs in life, and he commits similar sins. You know, there's famine. He leaves rather than trust God. He does the same thing. He lies about his own. Well, oh, that's my sister. And, you know, he does some of the same crazy stuff that Abraham does. But he eventually really, really becomes a man of God and trusts Him in everything. But he kind of falters here towards the end of his life. And he knows full well that the blessing in terms of covenant relationship that he's supposed to pass on that's come to him from Abraham now is supposed to go to the younger son, not the older son. But he loves his older son. He loves Esau. And so we see here that Isaac rebels against God's prophetic plan because he knew what should happen. And in his older age, he rebels against it. And this takes us back to Genesis 27, and I have that for you. We're going to read through the first four verses. Now it came to pass when Isaac was old, and his eyes were so dim that he could not see, that he called Esau, his older son, and said to him, "My son." And he answered him, "Here I am." Then he said, "Behold, now I am old. I do not know the day of my death. Now, therefore, please take your weapons, your quiver, your bow. Go out into the field and hunt game for me, and make me savory food such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die." Now, he's kind of reneging on what he should be doing by blessing the older son. We'll talk more about Esau, but you know, when we studied him, just to help you know, the vernacular a little bit, we called him Big Red, the living beer commercial. This is Esau. He is a godless guy. I mean, and so it's important to know that, and yet that's who he wants to bless with the Abrahamic covenant blessing at this point. Now, here's what God had said to him clearly earlier, to him and also to Rebekah, his wife, in Genesis 25:23. And the Lord said to her, to Rebekah, when she's pregnant with twins, "Two nations are in your womb. Two people shall be separated from your body. One people shall be stronger than the other, and the older, Esau, shall serve the younger, Jacob." So that's the order. Typically in the Eastern world, the older son got the blessing, he got the inheritance, he got everything. So some of you are here today because of that, because your grandfather, if he came from Japan or from Okinawa, for example, I'll guarantee you one thing, he was not the older son, because the older son stayed because they got the blessing and they got everything. It was usually the number two, three, or four son that came. Kathy's grandfather and her brother came because they were like three and four. We have no shot. Let's go to Hawaii and work on the plantations. So this is a very Eastern idea that's still, you know, really part of the culture here to some degree. The older gets everything, but God says not with these two, not with these twins. And Isaac is obviously quite aware of that. And in my opinion, Rebecca would never let him forget it either, because she seemed to favor Jacob, and Isaac seemed to favor Esau, which of course is not a good thing to favor either. But again, Isaac was willing to ignore God's word, ignore the desires of his wife, ignore his elect chosen son, who now had the birthright, because you remember the story about that, in order to bless his immoral, freeloading son. That's what he's about ready to do. So it's kind of interesting that Isaac gets one verse here. It's not the best story about him. He's had some other triumphs where he's really trusted the Lord, but he's in rebellion against God at this point. So let's go into the rest of the story here. So Rebekah overhears Isaac's request. That's in verse 5 to 8. Again, we're still back in Genesis. Now, Rebekah was listening when Isaac spoke to Esau, his son, and Esau went to the field to hunt game and to bring it. So Rebekah spoke to Jacob, her son, saying, "Indeed, I heard your father speak to Esau, your brother, saying, 'Bring me game and make savory food for me that I may eat it and bless you in the presence of the Lord before my death. Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice according to what I command you.'" And you know the story. She makes the meal because she knows what Isaac likes. And he's blind, and so she has garments of Esau put on Jacob so he smells like him. And I'm sure that was a wonderful cologne smell that he had, man of the field that he was. And then takes sheepskin and puts it on his forearm. See, I could pass right here. I could just totally pass for Esau right there. But he needs the sheepskin. And they go on and they propose this hoax upon Isaac in order to get the blessing. Now, Jacob doesn't want to go along with this. He's like, no way, we're not doing this. And basically says, listen, let the curse be on me, my son. Only obey my voice and go bring them to me, the articles that she has requested to do. So Jacob's going to go along with this. Now, Jacob really gets a bad rap sometimes by Bible teachers, but the criticism is of Jacob is primarily from Esau. Big Red, the Living Beer commercial, is not from God, which is very interesting. But he goes along with his mother's request and enters into the deception. Griffin Thomas says this. He says, righteousness can never be laid aside, even though our object is yet more righteous. See, to Rebekah, the end justified the means. In personal life and home life and church life, in endeavors to win men to Christ and missionary enterprise, in social improvement and everything connected with the welfare of humanity, we must insist upon absolute righteousness, purity, and truth in our methods, or else we shall bring utter discredit on the cause of our Master and Lord. So she what she's doing, her best, is to carry out the will of God. Now, we don't condone her methods or anything, but at least we appreciate what she's trying to do. She's trying to prevent her husband from making a terrible mistake. Because again, once he says the words, they're binding. They can't be taken back. It's not true in our culture today, right? We have politicians say stuff all the time, and later they say something like, well, that statement no longer represents the clarity that we now have in regarding to the specificities of the situation. See, that means I lied before, but I'm not going to admit that. But when it came to a blessing, once they said it, that was it. Now, when he pronounced the blessing, Isaac meant to give it to his firstborn Esau, but was deceived. Here's the blessing, Genesis 27, verse 20, chapter 27, verse 28. Therefore, may God give you of the dew of heaven, that which is a good thing, mentioned in the Psalms many times in terms of pleasantness, of the fatness of the earth and plenty of grain and wine. Let the people serve you and nations bow down to you. Be master over your brethren, and let your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be those who bless you. So that's the pronouncement of the blessing once the deception is in place. And if you know the story, Jacob then has to lie like three times. Are you sure? You're sure you're Esau? Yeah. That's me. Spell it. No. I mean, he kind of goes through this whole thing about three times, and then he gives him the blessing. That blessing is carried out in fulfillment during the life of King David when he conquers the Edomites, Edomites, and they become a vassal state to Israel until the time of King Jehoshaphat. But again, Jacob will later, and we'll mention it, pronounce a full blessing on Jacob, knowing who it is. Thirdly, Isaac repents of his disobedience. So Esau comes in later. You know, he's been out hunting. He prepares the game. He brings it in and says, "Hey, I'm here. Here's the meal. You can bless me now." And it's like, uh-oh, sorry, I did that already. And so at that point, it's very interesting, the response here of Isaac. Again, same chapter, verse 33. "Then Isaac trembled exceedingly and said, 'Who? Where is the one who hunted game and brought it to me? I ate all of it before you came, and I have blessed him, and indeed he shall be blessed.'" I think the key fact is he's trembling. He realizes that I've actually done what God wanted me to do. I was deceived in doing it, but I did what God wanted me to do. God in his sovereignty would not allow me to not do what he wanted me to do. So he's busted, right? I mean, that he realizes that. And that's why he's trembling here. Now, Donald Barnhouse, great commentary, says this: "Before a great work of grace, there must be a great earthquake." And that's the trembling here. Isaac had put his personal love on Esau ahead of the will of God. Down came his idol, and the edifice of his willful love collapsed before the shaking power that took hold of him. The arrogant pride which had slyly planned to thwart God toppled to the ground, broken beyond repair. When Isaac trembled exceedingly, all of his desires were shattered. Again, in our text here, chapter 11, verse 20, it just says, "By faith Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come." How so? Was it willful? I mean, in terms of sinful and blessing Jacob? No, rather Isaac, by faith, blessed Jacob, and he does that openly after this occasion. But God had to deal with Isaac, even in his older age. God help us to finish strong in terms of our walk and our journey with Christ, unlike Isaac here. But God fulfilled his word. Despite Isaac's opposition, despite Rebekah and Jacob's manipulation, and despite Esau's indifference, God's sovereign will still took place here, which is... That's to bolster our faith so that we can trust the Lord no matter what the circumstances are and no matter what our personal feelings might be in regards to the known will of God. The invincible determination of God will see to it that his people are sanctified in the end. You may not feel like it. You don't think you're ever going to get there. God will make a way to bring you around. That's why Paul can say in Philippians 1:6, "Being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ." Now, chapter 28 of Genesis, just to kind of complete the loop here, here now is Isaac's actual blessing when he knows that Jacob is standing before him, kneeling before him. And this is the blessing he pronounces upon him because Jacob is getting ready to journey on to go back to Padan Aram and look for a wife, which is all a fascinating story as well. But here Isaac says, "May God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you, that you may be an assembly of peoples, and give you the blessing of Abraham to you and your descendants with you, that you may inherit the land in which you are a stranger, which God gave to Abraham." So Isaac sent Jacob away, and he went to Padan Aram to Laban, the son of Bethuel, the Syrian, the brother of Rebekah, the mother of Jacob and Esau. Isaac gets one little line here, but he dies believing the future promises of God. He doesn't get to see them. Are they in the land? Do they have the land? Are all the promises there? No, he dies believing that they're coming. He's willing to place his faith based on what God would do in the future and not on their current circumstances. And certainly, I think that's one of the reasons these men are listed here. Third, Jacob now. Jacob, by faith, gives extraordinary prominence, we're saying, to Joseph's older sons. Verse 21, by faith Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph and worshiped, leaning on the top of his staff. Ken Hughes says, this is because to believe God's word and to base everything in the future upon God's word is worship. It's not that he was singing a song, nice little hymn, chorus. It's because of what he was doing and his actions here. Couple of things, and this is, you know, again, another very fascinating story. This is Jacob at the end of his life. Of course, Joseph, he's been sold into slavery by his brothers. Jacob has a bizarre family, that's highly understated, to say the least. A couple of the kids grow up and be mass murderers and so forth. I mean, it's a crazy story. There is a reason the Bible is rated R, I mean, if you start reading it. But anyway, it's kind of, you know, we go through some of these passages, and it's like, send your kids to Sunday school. We're in this chapter this week, you know. it's kind of rough in places. And that's Jacob's family. But Joseph, of course, has been faithful to God, even living in a very pagan, corrupted society, very sensual society. But his life has remained pure. He's trusted God. And this incident and this scene is the only place you ever find even a hint of anything with Joseph to say, oh, I'm not sure if he should have done that or not. It's the only hint. He's like the best example in the Old Testament of somebody, a young guy who lives a godly life in a very difficult and pagan culture, kind of like the one we're in now. And of course, we have men like Daniel that does the same thing in the Babylonian captivity. He becomes prime minister, of course, and then Jacob and the family are able to join them. Jacob lives out his days there in Egypt. Now it's the end of Jacob's life. Same thing, going to pronounce a blessing. So first we'd say Jacob changes the position and the status of the two sons of Joseph. And this is recorded in Genesis 48:3. It's extraordinary what takes place here. What he does at the end, Joseph has had two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. Jacob's getting older. He fears that he may be dying soon, so he wants to pronounce this blessing. But before he does it, he adopts them. He takes his two kids and takes them as his own, and he adopts them. And that's what takes place in Genesis 48. In verse 5 of that chapter, it says, and now your two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt, are mine. As Reuben and Simeon, his first two elders, they shall be mine. The literal Hebrew is, like Reuben and Simeon, they will be to me. In other words, your two boys are going to take the place of their two uncles in terms of my lineage. Now, there's reasons for this. Back in 1 Chronicles 5:1, for example, it reads, now the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, he was indeed the firstborn, but because he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given to the sons of Joseph. It's because of their sin. That's why he's doing this. The sons of Israel. So that the genealogy is not listed according to the birthright. Yet Judah prevailed over his brothers, and from him came a ruler, although the birthright was Joseph. So it's kind of an astonishing revelation at this juncture this idea that he adopts them. And there's a couple of reasons why Joseph would not be real thrilled about this, by the way. So in verse 6, Jacob anticipates the question of Joseph, what about my other kids? And he says in verse 6, your offspring whom you beget after them shall be yours. They will be called by the name of their brothers in their inheritance. So here's the adoption ceremony. It begins in verse 8. Then Israel saw Joseph's sons and said, who are these? Now that's like at a wedding ceremony when I'm up front and I've got the groom next to me, the dad or whoever it might be has walked the bride down the aisle, and I say, who has brought so-and-so to be married this day? And then that person typically says, her mother and I. Now we've started the ceremony. That's what happens in verse 8. Who are these? He's not confused as to who the kids are. It's the beginning of the adoption ceremony. And then it continues in verse 10. We have the conclusion. Then Joseph brought them near, and he kissed them and embraced them, and he bows down. He's not thrilled, but he's accepting what Jacob is doing, adopting his two older sons. And one of the reasons he's not thrilled about it is because they will be known as the sons of Jacob, who is a shepherd who lives in Goshen. And they are despised by the Egyptians, and there is no future for them in Egypt any longer. He's the prime minister. He has an Egyptian name. If they are his sons, they have a bright future ahead of them. So that's why he's not real thrilled about this with his dad. Then we have this whole other thing that happens. Jacob places his hands on them to pronounce the blessing. So this is verse 13. And Joseph took them both, Ephraim, with his right hand towards Israel's left hand, Manasseh, with his left hand towards Israel's right hand, and brought them near. So he positions them so that the older son would get the right hand, and the first blessing is the older, and the younger would be at the left hand, and he sets this up. Dad's not all with it, so I'm going to help him out, make sure he gets it straight here as he pronounced this blessing. And then I'm going to read from the New Living here in verse 14 and 15, where it says, but Jacob crossed his arms as he reached out to lay his hands on the boys' heads. He put his right hand on the head of Ephraim, the younger, though he was the younger boy, and his left hand on the head of Manasseh, though he was the older, the firstborn. So he's ready to do the blessing, and he goes like this. And again, Joseph's not real thrilled about that either. It's breaking protocol, to say the least. Here's where there's an interesting application here, though, I think, to help us, and in this quote by Donald Barnhouse. And Barnhouse says, it had taken Jacob a lifetime of divine discipline to learn that he must only speak and do the word of God. Now he dared to trust God and believe his plans were best. He dared to do God's will despite the wishes of his illustrious, and he was, godly son. Jacob had his anchor into the will of God forever. Because Jacob has his ups and downs, right? I mean, at some point in time, God even has to cripple the guy and make him walk just to cut, so he'd be a little more dependent upon him, and changes his name at that juncture from Jacob to Israel, which means governed by God. So he's an interesting case. Every time we talk about serving the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, instead of going, ooh, the patriarch. So we should go, wow, that's grace right there. You know, it's like, okay, yeah, our faith is for anybody. I can tell you that right now. Those guys and their kids, oh my gosh, okay, here we go. There's no one beyond the grace of God and being saved. It should just bring that connotation to us when we think about these men and God's grace. But in the end, their faith and their trust in him. Thirdly, Joseph does not want to accept the preference given to the younger. As I mentioned, he actually grabs his father's hands to try to reverse them. And the text says very firmly. And you get that little tinge that maybe he's ticked off right here. You get nothing from Joseph. Is just this godly guy all the way, right? From a young kid all the way through, never doubts, always trusts God. He's like this awesome example. It's like, this is the only place where it's like, I think you're kind of blowing that there, Dad. And you can tell he's a little ticked off by what's going on. This is a test of faith for Joseph, right? Because he knew what God wanted him to do, and he had done it. He had been faithful to God all these years. These are his two sons born to him in Egypt. He gave them names that were reflective, not of bitterness, but of his trust in God and the sovereignty of God, despite all that he had been through. And this is what Marcus Dodds, he's a Victorian era guy from Edinburgh, says. Very, very, very practical here in terms of the application of Joseph to us. Again and again for years together, we put forward some cherished desire to God's right hand, like Joseph, and are displeased, like Joseph, that still the hand of greater blessing should pass to some other thing. Does God not know what is oldest with us, what has been longest at our hearts and is dearest to us? Certainly he does. I know it, my son, I know it, he answers. It is not because he does not understand or regard your natural and excusable preferences that he sometimes refuses to gratify your whole desire and pours upon you blessings of a kind somewhat different from those that you most earnestly covet. He will give you the whole that Christ hath merited, but the application and distribution of that grace and blessing, you must be content to trust him. We've all got our right hand on something from time to time and saying, God, please bless this. And sometimes he says, sorry, going the other way. Are you still going to trust me? See, here's the test of Joseph that I think has tremendous application. Again, they were believing the promises that wouldn't even happen until after their death. We got a few of those, right? Like heaven, right? We got a few of those that we're trusting in beyond the grave as they were. But besides that, it was, can you put your personal feelings aside and trust me? And trust me in my sovereignty and what I'm offering to you. But I didn't want that job. I wanted this job. I didn't want to live there. I wanted to live here. I didn't. And then sometimes you just go, okay, Lord, whatever you got, we're going to roll with it. I'll trust you. I mean, that's the whole point of faith here. Jacob's faith on his deathbed was his singular triumph of life, one writer said. And of course, then it gets written to us as that triumph was actually worship. We're familiar with Romans 12, Paul writing, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, that's a total dedication to the Lord, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. But the NIV actually says, which is your spiritual act of worship. Giving ourselves wholly to the Lord means singing really good. That's worship. No, it's actually... Real worship is really giving ourselves to the Lord, and certainly Jacob reaches that point here on his deathbed. Fourthly, by faith, Joseph was able to look beyond the present circumstances, and that's in verse 22. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, now we get him at the end of life, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel and gave instructions concerning his bones. So Joseph makes a final request. And it's not because Joseph had already read the rest of the book and he knew the story, right? I mean, we got a long ways to go. He's going to pass off the scene. He serves under a Pharaoh that was non-Egyptian. And therefore, you can understand why that non-Egyptian pharaoh would have no issue bringing another Semite, a Jew, to be his prime minister. He wasn't Egyptian himself. Those guys historically pass off the scene. Now you have an Egyptian ruler over Egypt once again. And he's like, and they didn't remember Joseph anymore. So that's where that line comes from. Joseph doesn't know that, of course. And then the slavery in Egypt. There and Moses being raised up. He just knows the promises of God. And so in Genesis 50, 24, he says, "And Joseph said to his brethren, I'm dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land into the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt." Been there since he was 17 years old. Joseph's mummy then was carried out when they did leave. They kept the promise carried out by Moses, Exodus 13, 19, and it's Joshua in Joshua 24 that takes his mummy into the land and buries him in Shechem, where his remains are for today. Faith for the future based on promises of the past, and true for them, and certainly it's true for us as well. I wanted to close with a quote from Paul in 2 Timothy that I think will help us a bit. This idea that there's times like these men, and we'll mention some of the gals as we go through here as well. It doesn't mean they were perfect in their faith or they didn't falter in their faith. They certainly did. But God's grace and his sustaining ability led them to eventually be able to trust him fully. And so Paul writes this to Timothy. Of course, one of the last thing that Paul writes that we have, 2 Timothy 2:11, he says, "This is a faithful saying, if we died with him, we shall also live with him." So it's a promise of the resurrection, that we will be resurrected with him. Verse 12, "If we endure, we shall also reign with him." So there's the promise that one day we will rule and reign with Christ. "If we deny him, he also will deny us." And that is true. Peter says on the day of Pentecost, "There is salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men whereby we must be saved." Through Jesus Christ is the only way of salvation. And then he says, verse 13, "If we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself." So the reliability of God is greater than our performance all the time, every day. God cannot and will not be anything other than faithful to us. And that's why we can walk with him in faith. I'm going to go along just a couple minutes. I got to tell you this cute story. We're driving to the rally yesterday. Kathy and I were listening to one of the guys who's only on the radio on Saturdays on K-Light, David Jeremiah. Tells a story at the end of his message. And I told Kathy, I'm going to tell that tomorrow. Anyway, he tells a story. Pastor is flying across country. And he flies a bit, doesn't think anything of, you know, they come on, you know, we have possible disturbance ahead, you know, please make sure you're in your seat belts. You know, we've all heard that and everything. But I don't know if you heard this one, then they come on. We're going to be suspending our drink and food services because, you know, it's like, okay, you know you're going to hit something then, right? So everybody's kind of really buckling up. And then the pilot comes on, right? And he introduces himself. Listen, no, this is going to be a little bumpy ahead and so forth. Please, you know, please do everything you're asked to do and so on and so forth. And then they hit it, and they're climbing and they're dropping, and they're climbing and dropping, and stuff sliding around. The overhead bins are popping open and all that stuff. And he's kind of looking around, and he sees a lot of people. He can tell they're praying. It's serious, right? And they're praying, and other people are panicking. He says, but to the left of him, he could see a little girl, and she's sitting in her seat with her legs folded underneath her reading a book. She could care less. And this thing goes on, and this little girl never bats an eye the whole time. And finally, they get through the turbulence, and they get to the other side, and they come down. They land and everything, and then deboard, they go to luggage, and here's this little girl. He couldn't help himself. He just had to go over and say hello and just point out the fact that, you know, she'd been so brave and everything on the plane when they were rocking so much. And she says, oh, it's nothing. My daddy's the pilot. And he said he was taking me home. Whatever's is rocking in our worlds, our daddy is the pilot, and he's gonna take us home. And there's reason for us to place faith in him, despite our circumstances, like Ruth, that we saw last week, and certainly despite our own personal feelings at times, to know that we can still trust him. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness, and it's kind of interesting that we're reading about faithful men and women who would not be faithful at all were not for your grace. And all this to cause us to trust you more, and our world certainly is shaken. At times, we don't always like the circumstances we find ourselves in, and with war in the Middle East. But Lord, you're the pilot. You'll take us home. We can trust you despite our personal feelings and despite our particular circumstances, Lord. May we, by grace, grow in our faith and trust in you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.